ask you, what comes first, chicken or the egg? And I ask you that because here is a question I've always posed myself regarding my Sophronitis cernua, also Cattleya cernua for people that prefer to use the reclassified name. I prefer Sophronitis because it reminds me a lot about her culture. So the chicken or the egg, what comes first? Is it, in your opinion, when roots start that the orchid is doing something, so that's the start of a cycle? Or when new growths start? So in my case with my Cattleya cernua, I consider it the start of something when she's doing absolutely nothing. So I've taken a picture of part of my orchid where there's nothing going on, just to document what the growth habit of my cernua is. And then she doesn't do anything during the hottest part of the year. So June, July, August, even sometimes May. By May, she is done. She just rests. And then when there's a temperature drop starting to be evident at night, she comes to life. And that is when she starts to push out new growths. And suddenly, Sleepyhead becomes pretty active, pretty fast. New growths for me start at the beginning of October, mid-October, depending on how mild our Indian summers are. But you don't know if it's going to bloom or not until you notice if the leaves are chubby or a little bit flat. And that is where it was in my head, what comes first, the chicken or the egg, because the chubby little growths are actually like an egg protecting buds inside. So if you have a thin-looking growth at this stage of the growth, then chances are you're not going to get blooms. Maybe you might have one bud, but chances are no, if you don't see any rounding chubbiness in the growth. But never mind, because that is another storage unit for the orchid, so she's bulking up and getting stronger. But the chubbiness of a growth will determine if you will have blooms or not. But you still don't know until she cracks open, protecting the buds, because that by tonight will have opened completely. And then I would have missed the mark. But now we can see, oh, she's gonna bloom, because we can see she has something inside, besides the fact that it was a very chubby growth before the leaf cracked. And only after the leaf has completely opened will you then be able to see how the buds are inside, and you'll be able to count them. And then she blooms. Isn't that gorgeous? So I have this year three growths with five buds inside, plus two other growths that have yet to show me what they're going to provide. But the three growths with the five buds has already overstepped the number of blooms that I got last year. So last year I got 13 blooms, which I thought was pretty impressive. And my first three growths are showing me five buds each. So that's this one. That one's got five. And the one down here also has five. The other one that has cracked open here has four. So we haven't even gotten all of the growths to open yet. And I've already surpassed my bloom count for last year. And I'm very, very happy about that. Now this is a quick care video, quick in a sense that I wanted to show you the growth stages and ask the question, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? In my books, it always starts when the orchid is resting or not doing anything. And for me, that's the summer months. And that is when I only water her with RO water, not even with seaweed. But I do not let her be dry over an extended period of time, resting or not. My summers are super hot. I don't have any humidity to speak of. So I water her once, if not twice a day, simply to make sure that she doesn't turn into oregano. But no fertilizer, no seaweed. And then when the new growths start pushing, that is when I start to introduce fertilizer. And currently, I am fertilizing her with 300 parts per million. Every time she reaches almost dryness. That doesn't happen every day because we are in the cooler months of the year. I don't water her every day. I watch the moss and I make sure that it doesn't go crispy. And then I spray again. If it's not a sunny day and I have to water her, I don't want to risk anything happening with the growth, with the buds, with the closed leaves. I can spray her from behind and give her some water that way without affecting anything that's happening in the front. And as much as I like these inorganic mounts, she's not going to stay on that mount because you can see how much algae is around her. And I find that absolutely horrible looking, even though the moss is only 6 months old. And yeah, so in the past, I re-mossed twice a year simply because I don't like this aspect. I don't like it one bit, which brings me to re-mossing in the month of July, June, July, depending. That is her resting period. So I am not inclined to do that anymore because if I break a root during her resting period, that root is gone and she will not produce any new roots until she finishes blooming. So that gives me the opportunity then when she starts producing new roots that I am going to pot her up into a Rapiculus-Lelia setup. And what I'm trying to do at this point is train the growth underneath here to grow towards the light and be a little bit more perpendicular to the media so that nothing will be touching the surface of the media. That is why at this point she is living where she is on the back wall of my south-facing blooming alley area because I want the direct sun to hit her frontal in order to encourage the lower growth to come forward and up a little bit. That is the plan. Right now, if I had her facing west, I would be risking that these growths would just grow flat up against the mount because there's nothing encouraging them to grow towards the light. So we shall see when it comes time to pot her up whether that plan worked. But in the meantime, I'm giving her full fertilizer. This is direct sun because I've pulled her off where she normally lives, but she doesn't get this direct sun every day. Where she lives, she gets direct sun maybe 4 or 5 hours depending on the angle. And then it's a little bit dappled on occasions because the sun moves across the sky. But very, very bright light during the summer. During the winter, direct sun, and then the angle of the sun takes care of that part for me during the hot months, and she is just in bright shade and no direct sun whatsoever. And she lives outside in my climate on the Mediterranean all year round, which is great. If I had more like this, there would be more of them because I have space outside, not so much indoors. And we shall see more of her as she blooms out, especially for the Blooms for You series that has to come up. But I wanted to document more the growth habit in this case, and we do have a bloom open, which is nice to see, as opposed to a fully bloomed out orchid, because sometimes it is, I find it super interesting to see the stages of growth and what do I need to look out for in order then also to time my repotting correctly, because the new growth with Sophronitis cernua does not equate new roots. And that is important to note, that that is not the right time to repot. When the new growth start, it will take about 4 to 5 months before new roots start. So the timing is after blooming on a cernua to repot. And then she'll chuck out roots at a rate of knots, and then we're going to address her and put her in a pot so that I don't have to look at moss after 2 or 4 weeks going all green. So I don't have to worry about whether I need to re-moss or not. And I can leave her well alone during the hot parts of the year. And that is how I document my 12-month cycle of my Sophronitis cernua. And I'm wondering if you agree with me, whether it is when she starts new growth, that's the beginning of her cycle, and the end of her cycle is when she is resting, or vice versa. I think it's while she's resting. That is the beginning of her cycle. But let me know your opinion. I would love to know how you see it because I could be totally, totally wrong. Thank you ever so much for tuning in, for having a look-see of my cernua and the growth habits. Have a wonderful day. Stay safe and take care. Bye.